We've been getting a number of good questions coming in. Somebody asked the question to me whether or not their questions on the app are going to a real person or not. And I'm privileged to tell you the real person is this guy right here. He's very real. And then he texts them to me because I'm technically incompetent. And let me just, there we go. All right. And so we're going to start off with our first question. Oh, this is a good one. I think a lot of folks in this room are going to be able to identify with this. How to deal with a church member who, I heard that laugh. It might be you, be careful. Mm-hmm. How to deal with a church member who has bought into the idea that church should never address anything political because it might turn seekers away from the church and the Savior. All right? How do you deal with a church member who thinks that getting into politics is going to hurt our witness? What do the two of you think about that? Let's start with Sandy, and then Dr. Bacote, we'll go to you.
Yeah, I would say this is a danger. We have to be very careful when we talk about politics in this sense. I don't think we should be endorsing candidates. Now, the African-American church typically endorses candidates, and the white church says, oh, we don't do that. Oh, yeah, you pass voter guides, mm-hmm. which you may as well tell us who the candidate is, because all the issues you pick on your voter guide are the Republican issues, you know, and the Republicans all yes on them, and the Democrats all no on them. And I know you should leave off things like cares for the poor and has a strategy for the city and has a strategy for public education and all that. So we pass out voter guides. Don't do either one of those. And then I would say, when you know, we have to be careful not to emphasize one set of issues over the other, one set of partisan issues over the other. I'm very intentionally an independent, and the reason is I like taking out against both of you. And you know I'm not trying to persuade you to be in either party because I'm not in either one. So I just like it. It sets me freer to be a critic and rather than to be seen as trying to promote particular political issues. Now, having said that, I do believe we've simply got to teach our congregation some of the things we've been talking about this morning. And Vince started talking about Genesis 1:28. Let's just start there. This is the Lord's, everything in it. And we're his servants. And we take care of the creation on his behalf. And that includes politics. So I would just give everybody a warning that I'm not going to try to persuade you to vote for a particular candidate or join a particular party. But you're going to hear from me application of biblical truth to public issues because it's important what you think, what you say, and how you participate. And that's part of being salt and light. And if I don't make every one of you mad every once in a while, I probably didn't do my job. So I just have it out at the beginning. You do have to be aware of visitors because they might catch you on one Sunday. For example, one Sunday, who'd I take? I took out after somebody. And I realized later that was a mistake because I didn't, in the same sermon, take out against the other party, in the same sermon. And those visitors were just there that one time. They never came back. And they said, why? The pastor's a Democrat and we don't want to join that church. That's what they said. Now, I wasn't a Democrat, but I didn't balance out my critique. So I do think we have to be really careful about things like that because it's not just what you think, it's how you're perceived, and we need to be knowledgeable about how we're perceived. So you have to keep making the qualification for making statements that apply to politics. You have to keep educating Christians about why you're doing it. And furthermore, one reason you want to do it, you want them to do it. Your mama told you in social society, don't talk about religion and politics. And I say, well, I don't want to go to that party. It'd be really boring. No religion and no politics. And I'm saying, Christians, let's talk about politics. You should talk about it in your Sunday school class in ways that I said, nonpartisan, non-candidate supportive, with balance, critiquing both partisan groups, talking about the issues of the day. And we evangelicals need to get better about that. So I wouldn't shy away. And I suggest taking the heat that's required to set a framework for where salt and light talks about the meat that we're supposed to be salting and the darkness we're supposed to be enlightening.
Takeaway, you want to party with Sandy Willson. That's the takeaway right there.
Yeah.
But I know, Vincent, you have some thoughts on this.
First, I would want to help them to think differently about what it means to talk about politics. And then I would also... in as I said earlier, helping them understand that, well, do they want me to ever talk about Jesus as a king? Because if they, because otherwise, is that what they mean when they say they don't want me talking about politics? Because if he's really a king and you're part of the kingdom, just, you know, in other words, just a reframing on the basis of what you say you believe these things. And if you believe those things, then really you can't really mean you don't want me to talk about politics. And then I might want them to, in terms of thinking about loving their neighbors, to ask them, would you like your neighbors to be able to take for granted the way you take for granted many things in your own life? Because if you didn't take those things, because these things you take for granted, if they were a problem, you probably would want the church to be talking about politics, because your life's pretty comfortable. And a lot of people whose lives are not comfortable, who are experiencing, you know, love, the antithesis of love of neighbor, for them, if they come to church and nobody ever says anything about what their circumstances are, that God cares about their circumstances, to talk about politics is to talk about caring about their circumstances, is to talk about, you know, differing ways for us to facilitate that love for neighbor, politics being one, not being the only way, but one of the ways to do that. So I'd want to try to help reorient the way that people are thinking about that. And I mean, if I was in a conversation with that person, I'd want to tease out more what they mean when they say that, and then try to get them to think differently.
Yeah, leadership expert Max Dupree talks about the number one job of a leader is to define reality. So you're trying to redefine the reality of what they mean by political.
Yeah.
And say to them, according to the scripture, let's talk about politics from God's reality.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, okay. You got a question, Michael?
Yeah, the question, just to follow up on that, is I wanted to hear more. It says, tell me more about love, neighbor, and harm prevention in political environment, in which harm is defined in such a way as to include holding to orthodox biblical beliefs, i.e. biology, defining gender, sex, etc.
The short answer would be, you mean so that in our culture where there's the language that says, if you disagree with me, then you hate me, right? I mean, that sounds what that, when people are using that kind of rhetoric. The first thing I would say, I guess, is I do think when it comes to love of neighbor, and particularly when it comes to questions of sexuality, if you're not facilitating an environment in your church where people who are LGBT do not feel like they are being existentially asphyxiated all the time, then I think that's, you don't create a space for them to think you actually are really loving your neighbors, because you want them to be there, but you want them to pretend that they're not there. As long as you are not actually telling us anything about your experience, and as long as you're white knuckling it, and we say and we think you're managing your white knuckling well, then good to go. But we're not thinking about the lived day-to-day experiences of those people and the lived day-to-day experiences of those people in a sexualized society, and now a hyper-permissive society, and one that's celebrating all kinds of things, LGBTQ, and saying that your freedom is found in your self-expression, etc. Point being that if we're not helping to be the community for those people, then you can say you love them all you want, but what you're really saying is love for you means just be here and pretend that you are actually not a living human being, and that you're being, you know, tight as a spring all the time, because nobody's actually caring for you, and you get invited to weddings and everybody talks about how great marriage is, and you know you're never going to have that, and nobody's actually caring for you, and you're just there, you believe this, but you're dying in terms of your actual life experience. So if you're going to be their community and live out being their community, they will see that what you're saying means that you do actually care for them, because you're there for them. You're the ones who are showing up for them all the time. And if there are people you know who are same, that are LGBTQ and Christian or not, and you find out they're suffering, and if church people are the ones that are attending to them when they're suffering, that are attending to them when their families are abandoning them, and saying, we disagree, but look, we're gonna take care of you because you're our neighbor. And there's no asterisk about you because of being LGBTQ, et cetera. So if we're doing that, right, then I think people are gonna be, they're gonna be less able to say that. But I think a lot of times people's experiences within Christian communities is, can we just not talk about it? Meanwhile, by the way, would you like to come to my wedding? right? You'll never get one, but we'd love for you to come to our wedding. So I'm just saying, that I think that communal reality has to be altered as a way to begin addressing that.
Yeah, I would just say it's both and. I mean, we want to encourage our nation to have righteous laws, and we want to be the people of mercy that he just said, and we got to do both. It's like being a parent. I mean, you can be really popular with your kid, give them marijuana when they want it, and have the girlfriend come over and sleep up in the bedroom with them, and I mean, it'd be great. You'd be the greatest parent in the whole world in their mind, but you don't love them. Mm-hmm. So you have to love them, which means you take some heat sometimes, but they know you love them because you visit them when they got arrested and they're in jail, and you bail them out, and you care for them. So it's always both and in society, I think, as Christians.
So, Sandy, I think I'm going to throw this one in your direction because you raised the question about submitting to government authorities. And the 41% that Barn is talking about in terms of the pastors that are just thinking about leaving the ministry, you know, part of it is the LGBTQI+, part of it is the issues of race. But in the last 2 years during the global pandemic, we had all the issues of how do we deal with the government mandates that are coming out. So this question says, can you help me better understand why this obligation did not seem to apply to Christians who refused to obey COVID restrictions, such as mask mandates, claiming it was government overreach? I'm really struggling to understand why submitting to government only seems to apply when they agree with the rules and regulations. The Christian's ultimate heavenly citizenship. How do we help our congregations rethink about our lives and being mission-minded?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question. And I thought that a lot of that noise was conservatives getting their hackles up because government was trying to tell them what to do. And I'm going, well, since when did government not tell you what to do? But John MacArthur was leading the way, so let's just be real blunt about it. Some people like to pick fights and make their theological point by having a big fight. That might have been part of it, but in his case, I think also there was a legitimate concern that the government was controlling some groups, like churches, but not controlling other groups. And so there was injustice, I think, in the California application of the law. And most of the noise was coming from California, I think. I mean, I wasn't completely up to date. But the noise coming from California had some truth in it. What I understand is that Dr. MacArthur did try to go through private power relationships to get it resolved and couldn't get it resolved, so he made a big fight out of it. I don't like doing that. I think, you know, in every way, and I think this is what Peter is saying in his first epistle, y'all behave yourselves, and don't bring shame on the gospel by making everybody think you're just shrill, self-centered people. I think that's part of what Peter's concerned about. So I would just say, if there is injustice, let's do it in the most humble way, in the most, I mean, the two words that Dr. Bacote is humble and generous. Let's be as humble and generous toward others as we can and try to resolve the injustice. And if you can't, you know, use your appeal. We have plenty of forms of appeal and use them. But I would say we have to teach the congregation. That's what I had to do when that was going on. I did make it a point. Look, there are moments when there is real injustice, and there are moments when we're just misbehaving, like little teenagers, just misbehaving. We don't want any authority over us, and we're suspicious of the government. Well, Madison said it. You should be suspicious of individuals, but you should also respect government, and we Calvinists believe that we should be part of it, part of the government. So get in there and do something about it. That's what I would say.
All right. Another question that came up was, how do Christians engage in both candidates who have views in which they disagree?
Don't expect candidates to be a messiah. I think part of what we do is that in fact, it's almost like what happens with a presidential election, right? We know that we're a republic, which means that we don't have a king, right? But we act like we're electing a king or a queen if a woman is running, right? And then when they don't do what we thought, we're just like, but I thought you were going to act like a monarch and do things by fiat. It goes back to the whole civics thing. It's like, you know what? We're a republic. We are not a monarchy. So I think, first of all, there's a reminding people of what we are. But then I think there's getting people to think about, what are your actual expectations about how the political system works? The political system is not about one group is totalitarian over all the others. You have to live with other people. And everybody is not a Christian in this country. And so how are you making some penultimate good come through whatever you're doing in terms of public policy? So you need to look at, I mean, look at what kind of person they are, but and look at what they're actually saying that they're going to do. It can't just be a single issue thing. I think sometimes people say, well, you know, it's abortion for me. It's like, well, what does that mean? I mean, and even when you're talking about abortion, what laws are you talking about? And are you thinking about the lives of the people? I mean, I know that there are a lot of people, abortion is like a form of birth control for them, but there are a lot of people who are in distressed socioeconomic circumstances. And are you thinking about anything in terms of policy about the lives of those people? Are you thinking about what our adoption laws are like? Are you thinking about ways to help facilitate that? Are you thinking about trying to reform the foster system? I mean, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, is there something more holistic there than just a particular issue? So I think, whether it's abortion, whether it's a particular version of race, or whether it's a particular version of how you're thinking about the military, you have to be thinking about more than just a single issue, because most of politics is not just one issue. And so what about everything else that they're talking about? And then, of course, also, what kind of person are they? And I would say this, are they really, is it somebody who actually wants to be a public servant, or is it somebody who is being skillful in using rhetoric, but really, this is really about their status, their desire for power, and basically, you are just in the service of their ambition.
So let me dig down on that for a second, Vincent, mm-hmm. because I think that is a perception that people have, is that if you move into the political realm, mm-hmm. that you're really about power.
Great question. So first of all, power is not a problem, just like wealth is not necessarily a problem. The question is, how do you use it? How do you steward it? How do you direct it? Power per se is not the problem. How are you going to get justice if you have no power? How are you going to implement justice if there's no power? So power is not the problem. And what I would also say to them is, well, if that's your view of things and you do think people should check out of politics because of that, please don't complain because of the people who got elected and misused the power and now you're feeling it. Because you told them to go ahead and do whatever they wanted to do. You told them to check out. You said, you drive the bus, I'll go to sleep. And then when the bus got to a destination, you're like, what place is this? It's like, well, you told them to drive wherever they wanted to go, and then you didn't care. And so it's the unique agency opportunity we have in a situation like this is to, you know, is to be in this thing with sinful people and to recognize that, yeah, are some people going to misuse power? Yes. The fact of the misuse of something does not define that the thing itself is terrible. It's just like the same thing with Christian doctrines. Some people turn predestination into a doctrine I call a theological terror, right? Calvin thought that it was a doctrine of comfort. Well, there are people who are terrorized by that doctrine. It's like, have you read Ephesians 1? Have you read Romans 8? You know, doxological types of situations where you're talking about what predestination is about. This is not about terrorizing you because in the end God will say, I don't choose you. I always point students to say, show me a final judgment text where God says, sorry, I didn't choose you, is why I tell them. The point being that anything can be misused. The fact of its misuse does not tell you what the actual definition of it is. And I think that happens with power, politics, etc.
So this one question, and either one of you or both of you jump in on this, is regarding individual rights and freedoms versus our corporate identity in Christ. How do we balance those two things?
Well, let me say a word about the previous question. I do think that Dr. Bacote said something that was helpful when he just said, have you read Romans 8? Have you read Ephesians 1? sometimes if you just learn how to ask good questions and say, you know, if I'm talking to a pro-choice person, tell me what's really behind that. What are your concerns? Well, it's a matter of justice. It's a matter of women being able to control their own bodies, they say. It's a matter of letting people have privacy between themselves and their doctor. You know what? I believe all that. And if I'll listen to them first and say, you know what, I do believe in women having control of their own bodies, and a lot of times they've been abused in our culture, and I really care about that. And I care about the privacy of a doctor and their patient. I really do care about that. And then I ask them a question. How do you deal with the idea that science seems to have no answer for this, where there's some threshold of development of this fetus becoming a human being? Scientists can't tell us where that is. If you follow the science, it seems to be at conception. How do you handle that? I mean, I genuinely want to know, how do you get over that? I was talking to one of my extended family members, and she's, you know, a secular Democrat, and she was telling me about why she's, I asked her, why are you a vegetarian? I just want to, I mean, I know you like the food, I guess, but is there a principle behind it? And she gave me this, you know, it really hurts animals to be slaughtered and so on. And I said, I get that. I said, have you ever thought about the problem with abortions in our country? I mean, do you think those fetuses can feel anything? Here's what she said. I never really thought about that. How could you not think about that? Well, it's like evangelism. Sometimes you're just sowing seeds. And if you show that you listen well, you listen so well that you could articulate their position and say, did I get it? Mm-hmm. And they say, yeah. Then you can ask a question. I mean, it's like evangelism. Just realize you're sowing seeds, and you don't have to convince the person right there, but be a good witness of what you think is good, because your question about orthodoxy in society is a good question. We should be seeking to move society to laws and practices that conform to God's revealed will. That's just in everybody's interest. But we have to be careful how we do it. Now, the question you asked was individual rights versus corporate identity. I'm not sure I see the tension. I would say our corporate identity as Christians is, I'm a member of the body of Christ. I'm under the King of Kings. That's my nation. That's my eternal nation. I'm a visitor in this nation. I have a temporary assignment to it. I'm an American. But the flag I mostly fly is the cross. That's my flag. I do fly the American flag as my secondary citizenship. And I do believe in individual rights because I am a Christian. And I think the American heritage has allowed for that. And so basically then, it is the Christian Bible that grants rights. Here's the question, where do rights come from? The Puritans said they come from God alone. By the time you get to the American Constitution in 1787 or whenever it was, it's the consent of the governed. So what we have to realize as Christians in this society, formed by our Constitution, is that the populace is going to tell us what the rights are. So our only way of getting this in conformity with the law of God is to evangelize the citizenry, so that the consent of the governed is in conformity with the scriptures. That's the reason Adam said a non-religious people can't do this. Even Franklin admitted to that, that without religious convictions, you can't have this society. But you have to convince people. That's the reason you've got to be politically involved, because you've got to be religiously involved in every area. And then you've got to move the consent of the governed to biblical conformity. The Puritans never would have said government is by the people. They would have said it's for the people, but not by the people. That's an American conglomerate of evangelical reformed religion with the Enlightenment. So we're going to play by the rules. Those are the rules. You got to convince the individual to restrain their rights. As Os Guinness says, individual rights have to be constrained by righteousness. They have to be. And we have to teach people that. Teach.
This is going to be a sweeping question. I kind of conceptualize a lot of the questions that seem to be somewhat around the same. Dealing with polarization, So I want both you guys to address this and address it from the standpoint of how we ought to think about it, but also addressing it from the standpoint of many of us having elders in our church and leading parishioners on how to engage locally about these matters. So there's polarization around the matters of race with CRT, other issues with national American exceptionalism, nationalism, et cetera. All of these polarizing issues around politics in our church, how do we navigate those?
And also, Sandy, at one point, one of the questions was asking how your church did that with your zero tolerance policy.
Yes.
In terms of political misbehavior.
Yes.
So practically, if you could get to that after Vincent does.
Okay.
Sorry about that.
I was like, oh. Okay.
Well, Michael's pointing out there's a whole bunch of questions around this topic.
So I think with polarization, the first thing I want to try to encourage to the congregation is what I said earlier, is to encourage people to be humble and encourage this, for them to be the people who are leading the way with humility. And to try to, as gently as possible, help people to understand that most people just don't know that much. And that's why I use the term pretension to omniscience. And this is like, Sandy, what you said to your congregation, a lot of people, they are learning how. They're having a formation of how to operate toward other people that comes from people whose job it is to agitate society and to get ratings. And so they are learning to opt to function because Ben Shapiro told them a way to do something and it's not just, you have your left-leaning version, maybe Rachel Maddow showing you how to do it, whoever. And people are learning a disdain for other people. So am I reminding people of what they say they believe? And what are the implications of what you say that you believe? Again, if you say that you love your neighbor as yourself and love does no harm to a neighbor, how are you functioning in this society as you are when your rhetoric seems to say, well, I can harm my neighbor with my words, and probably, I can be really good at bearing false witness against my neighbor, and that I'm doing it a lot. You mentioned CRT, and since you did, I am going to go there and say, here's what I think people need to understand. CRT is just the latest smokescreen for people to not deal with race, because it was cultural Marxism before people were talking about CRT, and it's something else. It's always something that it's this thing over here. I'll bet you've got a flag in your home with a hammer and sickle and all this other stuff. And really, what the question really needs to be is, okay, what are you so worried about if you have to actually contend with the question of race? And if you have to actually deal with this? And I'll tell you what I think it is, since, I'm just kind of, now that I'm over 50, actually I'm closer to 60 now, but now that I'm over 50, I just don't care as much about things, what I'm going to say.
Plus, you're going to say this and walk out the door after it's over.
Well, hey, be that as it may. I think a lot of people, they have zero tools in their toolbox to deal with the question of race. And they do not want to contend with perhaps looking in their own hearts and acknowledging things that they would be terrified if they had to acknowledge the things that they actually believe certain things about people. I saw somebody post on Facebook something about the Juneteenth statement itself. Do you know what it says at the end of the Juneteenth statement? It says to the people, it says, it's a warning to African Americans. It's like, you're free now, but make sure that you don't get too caught up in idleness, which is a way of saying, by the way, you're free, but we know you Negroes are actually inclined toward laziness and incompetence, and so we just want to be a little bit paternalistic toward you, etc. I always think to myself, I want to hear somebody say that about wealthy kids.
Yeah, I'll say it.
Because there's this presumption about a certain group of people. Point being, getting back to the whole CRT thing, that there are ways, just because of the way our society has been formed, and arguably because of the way humans have been ever since Genesis 3, when Adam said to God, "The woman you gave me," there's been enmity between humans and a tendency to look at the other in a way that's distorted ever since the fall. It's what people do. And the way the race has operated has been a particularly malevolent version of that. And so if we're going to be serious about loving our neighbors, if we're going to be serious about people who we're singing all these songs about God, search me, transform me, it's like, do you really want him to search you? Do you really want him to smoke out everything that is displeasing to him? Are you willing for him to actually point those things out? Are you going to say to God, God, I don't want to deal with this CRT. God ain't talking to you about CRT. He's talking to you about the state of your heart and what you think about other human beings, whether it's about race or class, about whatever it is. And are you willing for God to actually point those things out? And rather than even getting to that, it's like, well, it sounds like CRT to me, which is just the latest way of saying, let's talk about something else. Or let's talk about the fact that I don't want to deal with the complexities of what it actually means to do the hard work of living together well with people that are not like me and with things that I do not understand. And I don't have the patience and the time to deal with it. And my life's pretty comfortable and I like my comfort very much. Please don't disturb my comfort. That is what I think happens with a lot of people. And they get permission to do that from people who they give a certain level of authority.
So how is humility the antidote to that, Vincent?
Humility means I'm willing to admit that I just don't know that much. You know, one of the blessings of doctoral study is discovering not how smart you are, but how much you don't know. It's like, I don't know, I can't read all this stuff in this library. It's like standing looking at the ocean and saying, well, I see a little bit here. But look at all that stuff. Man, it really makes me feel small. I really don't know all that much. This is not a crime. This is just acknowledging that I don't know that much. To say that I don't know that much is not a value judgment about me. It's just acknowledging what is true. And God gives me the opportunity to participate in his world, to steward his world, to know some things, to serve him in this world, and hopefully to glorify him in this world. I don't have to pretend to know everything. I can't know everything. I can't know most things. A few things I can know, maybe. And it's really okay to be able to do that. And so, but it is really hard to do that when you're dealing with things that have affected people's lives historically, and you've got to negotiate how you're going to be able to talk about those things, take on those things, and then think about how do we live well in light of those things. Last thing I want to say is this. When Steve McQueen made the movie 12 Years a Slave, he has two scenes in there that are long takes, the hanging scene and the whipping scene. And he was asked, why do you have those scenes in there? And he says because he didn't want to let the audience off the hook. People pointing to things about CRT is a way to try to get themselves off the hook, to not have to look at actual horror in the history of the world, particularly in this country, and the ways that people have been treated, and the ways that some people are still experiencing those things. And if you don't have to do it, and you can find a way to keep yourself comfortable, you know, is a temptation to which many people are subject.
The views we hold are usually deeply rooted, and when you get to be as ancient as Vincent is, you really are holding on to your stuff. You know, I'm obviously older than he is, so I know what it's like to hold on to your views. And so all of us have to realize that. And all of us have context, social location, things that have shaped us. And we live in a country where people don't have the same social location you did. And therefore, it's a marvelous opportunity to learn and to listen humbly. And let's just take race issues. There is no way some white person who's grown up in a suburb with white people and in a privileged sort of lifestyle who's going to understand without a whole lot of listening that comes in the midst of friendships, where you listen a lot more than you say. Because the George Floyd episode brought out so much that we were feeling but we didn't say it for a while, and that just took the lid off. Well, I always say, put your ears on. This is a great opportunity to listen, because these folks who feel wounded were feeling this all along the way. They just didn't say it. Now they're saying it. Well, let's listen. Look, as far as systemic racism, Calvin believed in systemic sin. He taught on it. That institutions themselves have sin in them. So when people are objecting to CRT because they don't like the idea of systemic racism, you've denied I think the Bible talks about that too, but there are principalities and powers, but our Reformed heritage is one of recognizing institutions are important and they have to be changed all the time because they're always falling into sin. Sometimes it's unintentional, but it happens. And so we Reformed evangelicals ought to be the first ones who are listening to somebody who's giving us a theory of systemic sin. And in this case, it's racism, and it hurts. This is not some impersonal issue. This is a very personal issue. I think the way to talk about it, Dean, is realize we're in a family. And one time I was talking to a college worker. She was over for dinner. She worked on a campus of an Ivy League school. She was African-American. She said, I asked her, I said, so this was right after Trump got elected. And I said, so what's everybody saying? She said, who are you talking about? I said, especially the African-American students, what are they saying? She said, they're done with white evangelicals. I said, well, what'd you say to them? She said, I didn't know what to say. What should I say? I said, do you mind if I give you a couple of ideas? She said, sure. I said, I know this is hard, but you can't be done with us. We're family. You can get mad, slam the screen door, and walk around the block, but you got to come back. We're family. And so we've had people fly out of the SBC and people fly out of the Presbyterian denominations because they just can't take this anymore. Slam the screen door, go around the block, and come back. I mean, this is family. This is a time for us to figure out what this family thing means. And then I said to her, the second thing is, that particular election was Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. I told you I'm an independent. I said, can you not grant that there are reasons one might want to vote against Hillary Clinton? I mean, I mean, we're all familiar with why you want to vote against Donald Trump. But she said, well, like what? I gave her about four of them. And she said, why has no one ever said this before? I said, because old white men like me don't want to admit this, you know, to tell you that some white people vote for Trump. So in other words, I think we've got to listen, and then we've got to encourage everybody else to listen. Mm-hmm. That's our role. In terms of engaging church members, if you're in a 150-member church, you know, the pastor becomes aware of it, or an elder becomes aware of it. He knows which elder is a good friend, and he deputizes them to go talk about their Facebook or their postings or whatever it is where they're being outrageous, and talk to them about it. You're leaving a bad testimony, and then confront them. If it's between two people, the temperature goes up. The more contrary it is to the biblical truth, the temperature keeps going up, and the more they're in leadership, it keeps going up. In a 1,500-member church, every member should have assigned pastors and elders, and they know who they are, and they're responsible for their flock. And so if you're misbehaving on social media, your elder should talk to you about it. It's just that simple.
Let me add one thing about what you're saying about the election thing. What I said to my class after 2016, that election, I came into my class, I taught Tuesday, Thursday, I came into that Thursday, and I said, here's what I think you need to understand. I said, some people are relieved and some people are devastated.
Right.
I said, some people are devastated because when Trump announced his presidency, I mean, he led with xenophobia, et cetera, whatever you might say, no matter what his reasons were for saying about what kinds of Mexicans, et cetera, the point is that it landed in a way that was xenophobic and made people nervous, et cetera. I said, so for some people, they think that now someone's been elected that's enabling all those types of things. I said, some people are relieved because people have been saying since 2015, or 2014, that the culture wars are lost, and that here comes a big progressive snowball, and evangelicals are going to be brought to heel, particularly around sexuality. And so they are relieved. And then I said, and you must remember this. If you think white evangelicals are going to vote for Hillary Clinton, in light of what people have been saying about Hillary Clinton since 1992, this was only going to happen with an angelic visitation or with God telling them. You know, it would take an absolute miracle for most white evangelicals to ever countenance voting for Hillary Clinton because of just what the reputational dimension was going all the way back to 92 when she was the first lady. So, and you know, there hadn't, her becoming Secretary of State and all that didn't necessarily change all of that. So I wanted them to understand there are lots of reasons why somebody might have voted for Trump, but there are also reasons why other people were absolutely, I mean, shocked, devastated, and didn't know what to do about it. Because I wanted them to understand that people are seeing those things in different ways. And
the point is, they're all in our family.
Yeah, exactly.
That's where I was going to jump in and blur the line between the facilitator and the participant now, is that your comments, Sandy, about being family. And, you know, your comments, Vincent, about the humility which attaches to the listening. You know, listening is a good first step in humility and asking good questions, good curiosity.
And I would say be willing to believe people, because sometimes even people listen. Something like this can happen. A friend of mine told, with an older white gentleman at his church, there was some event they were talking about. He told, this is my friend's an African-American man, he was told about being nervous about his son and what might happen with his son being pulled over by the cops, etc. After the event was over, the older white gentleman came to him and said, hey, that story you told about your son, was that real or were you just making that up for effect? Mm. Now, my friend, who happens to be a large African-American man, was very tempted to set aside his sanctification in that moment. But thankfully, you know, the spirit prevailed. But the point is that listening includes being willing to actually be willing to believe what people tell you. Because people can say that they are listening, but the entire time they're thinking, that just can't be true. That's one of the things why with the George Floyd thing, with people seeing the video, people who had never thought that all the stuff about being pulled over by the cops, et cetera, true, they were like, you mean it's real? And I think that's one of the reasons why it had the impact, because the video was viral, and so many people saw it, and people watched the whole thing, and they couldn't believe that they were actually seeing something like that happen, even though people had probably been telling them those types of things, maybe for some people for decades, and then they saw evidence of it, and then you couldn't disbelieve the evidence.
So I'd like to take what is being said by these two men, and I'd like to, as the stated clerk of the denomination, push this out there and say that's my hope for us, EPC. My hope for us is that with humility, we could listen, truly listen, not just hear. With the idea of I'm hearing you, but I'm really not hearing you, and I'm talking past you to assert myself and win the argument. But there is a genuine sense of willingness to listen and learn because we are family. Mm-hmm. And when we get upset and we go out and slam the screen door and come back in again to have that conversation, at this cultural moment, if we can't have that conversation, EPC, who can? I've heard people say to me, it's too hard, we can't do it. I don't believe that. I just don't believe that. I believe that God, we're an imperfect denomination by far, but there is something about the culture of this called out group of people where I think we have the possibility of having these meaningful conversations with humility that could really make a difference. And what if we did? What if we actually had that conversation in our churches and did it well with people who are so polarized? And we were able to be the people who brought some reason and some civility and some love to our neighbor and bridge the gaps in those polarities. Then just maybe, our neighbors around us would think we had some credibility in this good news of Jesus that we have to share. And maybe they would say of us again, as they said back in the apostolic age, behold, look how they love one another. And if we can't love one another well, even in those disagreements, and with humility listen, truly listen to learn, to understand to one another, I believe the EPC can do that. I believe this is a place where that can happen. I think you two gentlemen have helped us facilitate that conversation today. And I think the kind of questions, Michael, that I've seen that have been coming in have been pointing us to that. Mm-hmm. People wanting that kind of conversation and to do it really well.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's one word that I consistently came to mind, and is wisdom. I think there's a lot of wisdom up here and without me. And I say that because the Bible says that anyone who lacks wisdom, asks the Lord and he will give it to you generously. And with humility, we accept wisdom. And that's what you both had given us. And we're thankful for that. So can we give God praise for that? And so as our state clerk has already kind of given us the charge and exhorted us, I ask that you just pray over this time and that we take this and figure out how we can continue to move forward.
Okay, and I just want to let you know, too, that after this, the lunches, there's going to be a lunch for all of us together, because we're in a lot of different spaces today doing different things. But there's going to be a lunch, and Jimmy Scroggins from Family Church is going to be talking about evangelistic culture in your churches over lunch, and that's going to be a conversation in Knox Hall, which is the big fellowship hall. If you haven't figured it out yet, this building is a big square that makes its way around, and Knox Hall is right in the middle of that, and that's where the you can go either down the hallways, if they have them set up in the hallways, or in Knox Hall to pick up your box lunch, and then come to Knox Hall to hear what Jimmy has to say. I think you'll be blessed over lunch as well. So let's pray together. Lord, thank you for these two men and for both their minds and their hearts, their willingness to share the rich deposits of that which you have placed in them and which you have skilled them to cause us to think and to feel and to do. Lord, that we might be a place, that we might be a people that could have these conversations well. That we would be quick to listen and slow to speak and slow to become angry. As Michael has said, that we could be people who receive your wisdom. Wisdom that would bring about, insofar it is possible for you, to be at peace with all men and to think of the others before ourselves, to how we would disadvantage ourselves for the advantage of others, how to truly love our neighbors. Lord, we're far from that, and we're not the people that we wish that we were, and we come to this place in all humility asking you, who humbled yourself, to give us all the grace that we need, that we could have these conversations well, and maybe, Lord, by your grace, be a winsome witness for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we love you. We give this time, this day, this assembly to you, that you might receive the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, and together in unison, all of God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Let's hear it again for Dr. Bacote and Dr. Willson, please.
Thank you, man. Great to be with you.